All right, so as I mentioned, I'm going to give you a general overview, and then Jeff's going to talk about his project that he started this past spring. And we'll walk up and look at both sets of tunnels, because we have short tunnels and long tunnels, and they're two different styles, and I think that's really important to see. So why would you want to extend your season? And I'm sure any of you that have high tunnels or have thought about getting high tunnels have thought about these things. But there's the possibility for year-round income, which is appealing, and the higher yields and the higher quality of the produce and the higher prices you can get, and keeping your workers employed. I was talking to Wave before this workshop started about getting good employees and keeping them. So that's one way to keep them if you have work for them year-round. And also the local foods. More and more people want local foods. And what I can tell you from what we grew in our tunnels last year, we had no trouble getting rid of our produce in the winter because nobody has produce. So everybody wants it, the local restaurants, and it's not hard to market it when there's not any other produce around. So why might you not want to extend your season? Well, year-round work. Sometimes you need a little break, right? And with the high tunnel, it's pretty labor-intensive to get out there and on a sunny day like this, make sure the sides are rolled up, and on a cold day, make sure that you're out there and get the sides rolled down so you're not getting chilling injury on your vegetables or your transplants, so that's important. The increased management that goes along with it. As I just mentioned, the rolling up and the rolling down, a lot of people think they can have a high tunnel and everything will go smoothly. Just if you put it in there, they'll grow, and that's not the case. The higher production cost to start, I think, I've heard several people mention that they got their tunnels through the NRCS EQIP program, and other folks mentioned through the Tennessee Department of Agriculture Ag Enhancement Program. So in Tennessee, that higher production, the higher costs to start right now aren't really a barrier because there's two programs out there, and I gave you the information on the NRCS program that will pay for a tunnel for you. So I think everyone should use those funds while they're available. And the NRCS has that program. It will be going again this year. So if you haven't taken advantage of getting a tunnel from the NRCS, definitely sign up for that, because who knows how much longer you'll get a free tunnel. And then disposal issues with plastic. And that can be high tunnel plastic, which you can repurpose for other things once you take it off your house, or it could be the black plastic that you might use with the inside your tunnel or outside the tunnel. So how can you extend your season? Of course, plastic mulch is one way to extend your season by warming up the soil, but we're not going to talk too much about that today besides Jeff talking about it in the context of using it inside and outside his tunnels. And then row covers and low tunnels we'll talk about, and the high tunnels are the hoop houses. So some of the advantages of the row covers are protection from frost, and protect the plants from the wind, also from the insects, enhancing your maturity and your yield and improving your overall quality. And there's a couple of types of row covers, and we'll talk about them. There's the floating row covers that are made of a spun bonded polyester fabric or polypropylene, and they're so lightweight that they float, hence their name, floating row covers. And we'll talk a little bit about those, but we mainly use those during the warm season, lightest weight covers. And then there's hoop supported covers or low tunnels, and you can see an example of those out the door, and they're usually made of clear white polyethylene, though ours are made out of a spun bonded fabric as well, and they're usually too heavy to float, so they're supported. So the floating row covers will vary in weight, and that difference in weight is very important, because if you get a heavy cover on there in the summer, you're going to cook your plants really quick, and if you get the light cover on there in the winter, you're going to freeze your plants really quick. So the heavier the cover, the greater the frost protection is going to be. And the size can range from 3 to 60 feet in width and great lengths from 20 to over 2,000 feet. The larger your cover, the more labor efficient it is. And I know for a lot of you, labor is at a premium. So if you get a larger cover, you can cover everything at once instead of having short widths and having to cover lots of ground that way. And then the durability is going to be related to the weight and the material. We like to be fairly gentle with our covers so we can use them as long as possible. And we can usually get 2 to 3 seasons out of them pretty well before they get torn up. So we use our lightest cover not in the winter but in the summer for insect barriers, and we put that on as soon as we transplant things into the ground. It can exclude the egg-laying moths and things like our coal crops that the cabbage worms love to get on and chew up. Also, they're indispensable for our eggplant. The flea beetles can get on that eggplant, and if you don't have the row cover on there, there goes your eggplant. But you can keep that row cover over eggplant until they flower and get a nice big plant that can take the flea beetles then, and it's not going to eat them, they're not going to eat them down to the ground. They can also prevent viruses that are spread by the insects, but these lightest covers are very easily damaged and generally not too reusable, and they really don't affect the temperature at all. The medium weight covers are most common, and they can enhance maturity and improve the quality and yield, and they can also be used as an insect barrier, and they're basically used on pretty much any crop, even sweet corn, though we've never tried it on sweet corn. Yeah, 0.55. Once you get above one and up would be the heavier weight. Yeah. So the heavier weight covers are going to be over 1 ounce per square yard, and they're used mainly for the frost and freeze protection, and also when extra durability is necessary. And they can be reused 3 or 4 or more seasons. So the row cover installation can be manual or mechanical. We do ours manually. And generally, you want to lay it immediately after transplanting or seeding if you're using it for an insect barrier, and weigh down or bury the edges. We've tried various things for weighing down our edges with variable success. Last year, we used sandbags, and we had that real intense wind that we were chasing our row cover across the farm trying to get it back down. We've also used the pins. Sorry, I still have these brain lapses, especially since my son decided it was time to get up at 4:30 this morning and didn't go back to sleep. So we've used the pins, and they've ripped out, and then we can't use our row cover again as easily next year because we have big holes in the edges. So what we found worked the best for us was our T-posts that we weren't using for tomatoes in the field, and we've laid them along the edge, and they can keep everything down pretty well and cover large amount of area, and that worked well for us. Does anybody else have good tips for holding down your row cover? Wave.
Although when we did lay them over the tomatoes last week, the stakes went right.
Oh.
I have a question. What about deer? Does this help keep out deer?
The question was if this will help keep out deer, and that's a good question. We haven't had a problem with deer on this farm, so I don't really have a good answer to that. Does anybody have an answer for that one?
My farm, we got a 7-foot fence around everything.
That'll keep them out.
I have 14 deer every morning. Get some deer. You can't shoot them. Won't let you. You come on that breakfast on my porch. That's all the deer you want.
I would think that it probably wouldn't deter them for very long if there was something good they wanted to get in under there. I think they would get to it anyway. But
we had about an 80% loss of our pepper plants the first night after we planted.
Ooh.
That's several acres.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, I think the deer, the 7-foot fence is probably a much better deterrent, but hard to do over a large area.
I mean, you got 7 acres, it's kind of expensive.
Yeah.
Dogs work, yeah.
I knew a guy with a peach tree nursery, and he just ran a single metal line that he electrified with the peanut butter on it. The deer would start to associate, every time they'd go for that line, they'd start to associate with shock, and it kept them out of them.
Did you have something to add there?
Over at North Carolina State University, I noticed that they ran 2 electric fences with about a 3-foot space between the two.
Mm-hmm.
And it said that the reason for that, deer can't tell depth, and they won't cross that.
Right. Yeah, you can also do them slanted out, several wires going up, slanting out, because they don't have that depth perception, and they'll hit it, but again, on a large acreage, that gets pretty expensive pretty quick. But deer, there's no easy fix for a deer. I had a bean trial in Crossville last year, and in the spring, there's plenty to eat. They didn't touch my bean plants. They went up and down the rows, but didn't gnaw on them. The fall, we replanted it. We didn't harvest a bean off of them. They just mowed them right down all the way across. So this year, we used an electric fence, and it wasn't an issue this year that I know of. So the other thing about using these row covers when you're using them in the summer is pollination. So the crops that are self-pollinating, you can keep them covered most of the season. So your lettuces and things that are leafies, it's not going to be an issue. Cabbage is fine. But things that flower, like the eggplant that I mentioned, as soon as they start flowering, you want to make sure that you're getting those row covers off. One, because if the temperatures get too hot under those covers, it's going to drop your blooms and you're going to lose your blossoms. And two, because you're not going to get that pollination if they're insect pollinated. So you want to make sure that you're getting them off for things like your cucurbits and the solanaceous crops. So the hoop-supported row covers. Generally, these are going to be smaller structures, and they're going to be 14 to 18 inches high and wide enough to cover one bed. Ours are a little higher than that, but we don't get down on our elbows and go in under those tunnels. If we're going to work on them, we take the cover off. And they're commonly used with black plastic, so you have that layer of black plastic on the ground, and then you have the row cover over it. And a lot of these covers aren't permeable to air and water. Our covers are that we use because they are the spunbond fabric. But a lot of folks use a layer of spunbond fabric, and then they're going to put another layer of plastic over the top. And the Deisinger brothers from Williamsport, Tennessee, that have Bountiful Blessings Farm, I'll talk about them later too because they have movable tunnels, but their low tunnel system, that's what they do. They have the fabric, and then they have the impermeable layer over the top of that. And they're pretty good about getting in and out of those tunnels throughout the winter.
You're saying that their fabric goes on the ground?
No, the black plastic goes on the ground like a bed, and then for the hoop, we use the fabric. But other folks do use the fabric and then another layer of clear plastic over top of that to keep it warmer under that little...
That fabric does not go on the ground.
No. Right. No fabric on the ground. Especially landscape fabric with those holes.
Mm-hmm. So are those two layers of your permeable and your impermeable, they're right together?
Yep.
You don't have two separate rows of hoops?
Nope. They'll naturally get a space between them. Yep. So these are more labor intensive, especially if you're covering over every little bed that you have instead of one big house where you can walk in and out of. And there's several different types of low tunnels. There's slitted row covers and punched row covers and some teepee-like row covers, and we'll talk about each one of those. So the slitted row covers, I have a picture of them there, which is probably a little hard to see from the back of the room, but they have pre-cut slits in them for hot air to escape, and they'll naturally open on their own as it heats up in there, so you don't have to manage that. And the slits will close at night to prevent heat loss. So they're kind of handy in that regard. The punched row covers are going to have holes about 4 inches apart that are going to ventilate inside that little tunnel, and they're going to retain their heat better than the slitted covers, and they're used generally more in the northern areas. So you might see those and think, ooh, I might want to try that out, but here in the south, they have a tendency to overheat, so you want to be careful of that. But I wanted to mention them in case you do see them and know that they're probably a little too warm for this area. But they're generally used for peppers, tomatoes, eggplants, and cucurbits. And then there's the teepee-like row covers, and they're definitely labor-intensive to make these little teepees. But basically, you use 2-3-foot wide plastic sheets and staple them together at the top, and they're good for the trellis crops like cherry tomatoes or long beans and bitter melons. And they can be more expensive and, again, a lot of labor to put together, but probably a little more aesthetically pleasing. So survival of cool season crops. For year-round production, the cool season crops are what you're going to focus on, and there's some that are very hardy and some that are hardy and some that are semi-hardy. And those very hardy crops are the ones that are going to be able to survive down to 5 degrees or 0 degrees in the case of parsnip roots, or spinach from 8 to 12 degrees. And then your hardy crops are going to be a little warmer from that 10 to 20 degree range generally. And the semi-hardy crops are going to be hardy to about 20 to 30 degrees. So knowing your weather conditions on your farm, because there can be different pockets of weather, and knowing the kind of protection that you have with the low tunnels or the high tunnels, you can decide what crops you want to put in what situation on your farm.
Do you know where choys fall there?
Choys, that's a good question. I would put them probably in the hardy category. All right, so that was low tunnels, and that was a brief overview of low tunnels. But the high tunnels, or the hoop houses, as you're probably all familiar with by now, are arch frame coverings with clear plastic. And they're high enough to stand in or to drive your tractor through. And they're solar heated, so you have no heating costs involved. And that's really the advantage with the high tunnels, because the heating can really drive you over the edge. So crops grown in the ground with drip irrigation, you're not using tables like in a greenhouse and growing up off the ground, you're putting them right into the ground. And they generally range in price from about $1.50 to $3 or less per square foot. So they're pretty reasonable as far as a greenhouse structure goes. And some growers say that they can pay for themselves in one season, and others say it'll take two or three for them to get your money back out of them. So the features of high tunnels, depending on the model, is that you can drive a tractor through them. They can be moved from field to field. They can be fully open on hot days, and they can be completely closed on cool days early or late in the season. And there's many, many variations on high tunnels now, and I think this is good to talk through with folks that are just putting some up, so you can hear what others have done and what they like about their tunnels and what they don't like about their tunnels, so you can avoid some of the mistakes. And we'll talk about that when we go up to our tunnels as well, because there's definitely pros and cons with both types of tunnels that we have up there. And this is just showing some of those things. This is the Hay Grove tunnels, so they're driving a big tractor through there, and then he's moving the tunnel over on the right-hand side there, and they're showing it fully open there at the bottom. Our tunnels don't open quite that wide, but our sides do roll up. So features of all high tunnels are you're going to produce higher quality crops than those grown in the field. And I know a lot of you have been to our field tour here and heard about our production and tomato production in our tunnels and the differences in quality with the tomatoes. We actually are getting more of the secondary compounds, the lycopene. We have higher levels of lycopene in the tomatoes we grow in the tunnels, and that is really a marketing tool as well. If you can tell people they're getting more nutrients out of your crop when they're grown in the tunnel, that's another thing you can market. So the producing crops earlier is another advantage of the tunnels. We can hit the market when the prices are high. We always like that in the spring when we have the early tomatoes. We, again, don't have a problem marketing those. Once the rest of the tomatoes hit the market, that's the end of our tomato market. But we can get those higher prices when we have the tomatoes first on the market. And it will allow production of certain crops year-round. And we'll talk more about that. So I think I've already made this clear, but just in case, the tunnels will provide some protection from low temperature, but they're not going to protect against frost like a greenhouse. So you're not going to plant warm season crops like a tomato right now and not give it any heat and expect it to produce a lot of tomatoes. For warm season things, it's going to give you about 3 weeks in the spring compared to field planting, and it also is going to extend your season about a month in the fall. For the cool season crops, you can plant them throughout the year, and some will do better than others, and we'll talk about that as well. So now we're going to talk a little bit about location and site preparation, and this is all advice from Allison and Paul Wiedeger. And if you picked up their book over here, Walking to Spring, it's an excellent book that they put together from their experiences of putting their high tunnels in, and they're in Bowling Green, Kentucky. And I'll also give a plug for their workshop that they do at SOG in January. They do a 2-day workshop on high tunnel production. And if you haven't taken that, I would highly encourage you to go to SOG and take their 2-day workshop. This workshop, I can't possibly cover everything because we have a limited amount of time, and I'm kind of giving you little bits and pieces. But I can honestly tell you in 2 days, you won't get bored listening to them talk. They're kind of like a comedy team, so they go back and forth between the two of them, and they keep it very entertaining, but you get an amazing amount of information as well. And they give you their spacings of everything they grow. They give you the varieties they grow, and it's definitely worth it to go and listen to them because they've been doing this, and they can really cut out a lot of your frustration. So their suggestions for when you're thinking of where to put your tunnel is locate it near your house, because they say you don't want to have to walk too far on a cold day to get to your tunnel. And they want you to make sure you're keeping it level from side to side. And from end to end, you want no more than about a 3% slope when you're setting up your tunnel, which is sometimes hard to do in East Tennessee. So that's an important thing to consider. You want to make sure that your drainage is good, because oftentimes you think, okay, it's protected from the rain, so it's going to be dry in there. And if you don't have good drainage, you're going to be ankle deep in harvesting inside your tunnel. So drainage is important, and it's easier to take care of drainage before you set it up than trying to tile it after you have the tunnel there. And we've had a few issues with drainage in our tunnels, and we're still working on that. You also want to avoid any wet, shady areas and obstructions to your ventilation, because ventilation is extremely important in a tunnel, and that ventilation and airflow is one of your best defenses against diseases. So you want to make sure that you aren't obstructing your ventilation. So orientation of your house. There's debates on which way to orient your house. And one facet of folks out there says oriented to capture the most light in the winter. So for locations south of 40 degrees latitude, the ridge of the house should run north to south. But Dr. Lewis Jett, who was at the University of Missouri, who's now at West Virginia University, but we won't hold that against him. I had to throw that in there for Heather. Sorry, Heather. He says that tunnels should be oriented perpendicular to the prevailing wind, and that sunlight is less important than ventilation. In Tennessee, the sunlight is definitely going to be your limiting factor. So you want to think about that when you're putting your tunnel in, but we do have ours perpendicular to the prevailing wind here, so we do get that ventilation of our houses. So design and construction. There are many resources to help you with design and construction, and you can see the resources at the end of the PowerPoint presentation, and they list all sorts of different construction resources there. Most designs are going to use a heavy gauge galvanized metal bow attached to metal post driven in the ground 4 to 6 feet apart. Now that 4 feet apart is generally, again, for northern climates where you have a higher snow load. Here you can get away with the 6 feet spacing and you'll be fine. You shouldn't have any issue with the snow down in Tennessee. If they're 6 feet apart, you're not going to get inundated with snow unless you live in the mountains, in the Smokies. So you should be fine here. But strength is very important, and the most critical components for the strength are the end walls. And you'll notice when we take our tour of the tunnels, our end walls are also metal, but a lot of folks use wood for their end walls, and that's perfectly fine, and it'll save you a lot of money compared to our metal ends. So again, it's all about how much money you have to spend on your tunnels and the look you want out of your tunnels and what you want to get. So end walls, the end wall design, and there's a lot of different designs for these, but generally many folks use wood end posts with 2x6 boards and corrugated fiberglass panels for the end wall glazing, and industrial steel frame doors with heavy duty latches. That's proven long lasting for the Noble Foundation. We have my mind is going on the, what do we have on our end walls?
Polycarbonate.
The double wall polycarbonate is on our end walls. And if you're going to use that, I'll tell you now, it's a good idea to seal the bottom with tape or something else. You'll see in one of our tunnels when we walk up there, we have a little histogram going because we have fire ants that have decided to tunnel up in the ends of our polycarbonate. So think about that when you're constructing your tunnel, because now it's a little hard to get something in and under there. So it's interesting to see the progress that the fire ants are making on that end of the tunnel. But so the covering for these tunnels is generally 6 mil greenhouse grade UV treated polyethylene. It's most economical and it's generally going to last 3 to 5 years. You can eke out a few more years here or there if you take good care of it. And they say that the light quality is actually the best in the second and third year. So So the first year, you're not getting as much light through. The second and third year, you get the best light quality out of them, and then it starts degrading again. You don't want to use any plastic that's not UV treated. It's going to fall apart halfway through the season, and then that's not very conducive to your growing if you don't have any plastic on the tunnel. John?
Maybe we could have some discussion about the different plastics out there, because there are many of them.
There are. There's a lot of newer type plastics that a lot of the greenhouse companies that'll want to sell you that they say are more resistant, they'll last longer, the price tag's higher, the light quality's better. If it were me, I think I'd go with the standard 6 mil.
Have in particular read good things about the infrared blocking, but I don't know how that works. So does anyone know about it?
Anyone know about infrared blocking through the plastic?
I don't know, even know if blocking is the correct term, because I believe the earth re-radiates infrared, so I'm not sure if we're blocking coming in, out, or both, probably.
I don't know about infrared, the greenhouse glass and stuff made for this, like the Plymouth polycarbonate and whatnot, will filter out UVB radiation all the time, so your plants are only getting the UVA, but I don't think I've seen anything about infrared.
It's supposed to be helpful with hotter temperature, so it can prevent some of your worries on overheating is what I've read, but I don't know, again, enough about it to.
I'm not familiar with that myself, that I could contribute to the plastic discussion. The light is altered enough inside these tunnels that's another bonus of the high tunnels, is that the insects get in there and they'll either not fly in at all, or they'll get disoriented once they're there and not be able to find your plants. They found that Japanese beetles actually won't go in a tunnel, so that's a bonus if you're growing
what about bees?
Fruit trees.
Pollination?
Bees don't seem to be affected so much by it. I mean, a lot of folks use the bees for pollination. There is a type of bee that is affected, and somebody help me remember that. Who was telling us that the bees do get disoriented in there?
I think honeybees have a harder time than
the bumblebees. That's what it was. Yeah.
So what do you do?
Well, you can get boxes of bumblebees that you buy and replace every 6 weeks or so, but that can be pretty pricey. Or you can encourage native pollinators by planting flowering habitat in between your tunnels or on the side of your tunnel and having the sides open to let the pollinators in. We're going to use bees because we have strawberries up there and we'll need them pollinated during the winter when we'll have to buy them and stick them in there to get the pollination.
When you say they get disoriented, does that mean they don't pollinate at all, or does it mean that they just don't pollinate as effectively, or what does that mean exactly?
Well, honeybees will try to get out.
Oh, okay.
So they'll find a hole and get out of the tunnel. Or they'll spend their time trying to get out of the tunnel.
Even if the hives are in?
Yes. They don't like being inside that tunnel environment, so they'll spend their time getting out. All right, roll-up sides. Make and allow for easy, effective ventilation. If you have any sort of roll-up sides on your tunnel, it's going to make it harder to keep it warm. You're going to have air getting in there. And in our tunnels, the small ones and the larger ones are definitely more airtight than the small ones that we have, and that's because of the design of the roll-up sides, and we'll look at that when we tour the tunnels. There's many different ways to keep your curtains down. One way to do that is to tape a 1-inch pipe that runs the length of the tunnel on the bottom, and that's going to hold it to the tunnel so it doesn't blow out in the winter when the wind's going. This design is from a tunnel at Ohio State where they have a T-handle and they attach it up at the top to hold the curtain on. It's about shoulder high, And so that's where the roof starts and the curtain comes down. So their curtain just starts there. They can take that plastic all the way out if they want to in the summer and let the air go through, or it can remain there. But it's two different sheets of plastic. So they have their roof plastic. Well, actually three sheets because you have two sides. So they have the roof plastic, and then on each side they have this curtain that comes down. But again, there's very many different types of curtains. There's roll-up curtains and roll-down curtains, and there's advantages of both of those, and again, we'll talk about those when we get up in the tunnels later on. Here is our first set of high tunnels, and they have roll-up sides, or roll-down, depending on how you look at it. I always get these confused. Here's a roll-up side, so that's what we have on ours, and you can see them rolling up. And the way that you roll them up can vary, and we'll look at that as well. This is the Weidigers, one of their tunnels. As you can see, this one does not roll up, and they don't want it to roll up because they want to retain as much heat as possible inside their tunnels. So they have wiggle wire right around that edge to keep it sealed nice and tight during the winter. And that works for them because they're growing greens mainly in these tunnels throughout the winter, so they don't need to raise and lower the sides. All right, in a high tunnel, irrigation is going to be essential because you're not getting any of that overhead rain. And the irrigation can be by hand, by drip irrigation, or overhead emitters. Generally, drip irrigation is going to be the most hassle-free for you. It's going to use your water and fertilizer efficiently and reduce your competition from weeds. And you can work in the tunnel while you're irrigating if you're using drip irrigation. It's also going to decrease your disease potential. We've talked about irrigation before, that you want to keep that water off your canopy, plant canopy, as much as possible, because that's going to deter your disease. The floor covering inside the tunnels, you can not have any covering, which is what we have in our tunnels, or you can use the landscape fabric inside the tunnels that's 6 mil, or you can use the 6 mil black plastic. And that's going to help, again, warm your soil just a bit more inside the tunnel than if you don't have any covering on the ground. It's going to help with weed control. It's going to help reduce your soil loss of soil moisture, and it's going to be a barrier against diseases from soil splash. So there are advantages to having a floor covering in there, but it's not essential. It's another thing to think about. So temperature management in your tunnels is very critical to your success. And as we've talked about, the sides, you need to get out there early on a sunny morning and get those sides roll up to prevent rapid temperature rise. And on a cloudy day, you want to be out there rolling your sides up to reduce the humidity and disease pressure. Rolling down the sides at night, of course, is going to conserve your heat. And 20 by 96 is a common size, and this is partially because it allows for an efficient heating and cooling. If you get over 100 feet, you don't want a tunnel that's longer than that because it's not going to, the air's not going to circulate very well, and then you're going to have pockets of disease in there. So you want to keep your tunnels under 100 feet, and 96 feet long is the common size there, with no added fans. So a little more advice from the Weidigers. They use one 20 by 96 tunnel plus two 21 by 60 foot tunnels for their production, and they suggest building as large a structure as is practical. First off, because they say once you start growing in a tunnel, you'll find more stuff to put in it, and you'll wish you had a bigger tunnel if you started small. So they say start as big as you can manage, and also the larger your structure, you're going to retain more heat in the air and the soil. The plants grown along the walls do not grow as well as the plants further away, so if you have a larger tunnel, you're increasing that interior space as well. And they use a double layer of 6 mil plastic for covering their tunnels, and they have a small fan that blows air between those two layers, so they have good insulation between them. On our tunnels, don't do what we did. We intended to have a fan there at some point. We don't have electricity up to our tunnels, so we had talked about getting solar power up there to inflate the layer between them, but we haven't done that yet, and that's the worst possible thing you can do, is have two layers of plastic that are touching each other, because that's going to make them break down quickly. So don't do that. So we have two layers on one house, but they're together. Other ways, if you don't have electricity and you're just putting the plastic on for the first time, is you can take a layer of drip tape and batten down the first layer of plastic with that, and then put the second layer over top, and that'll naturally create insulation air between them. Or what some folks have done, some of the Mennonites up in Kentucky take styrofoam blocks and put those in between the two layers of plastic so they have that barrier there without having an electric fan. But if you have electricity, that little fan to blow the air between the layers, it'll cost you like $5 in electricity for the year. So it's not a big investment. And if you have that, that's pretty easy to do if you don't want blocks of styrofoam in your tunnel. And
the other advantage of having the two layers of plastic with the inflated is that the wind, with the high winds, it doesn't hit the plastic and try to tear it.
That's a good tip too, yeah. If you have that insulation, he's saying that it doesn't whip the wind and doesn't try to tear it as much. And our second tunnels that we have, the longer tunnels, we have one layer of plastic on them, and that's worked pretty well for us. Work done from Kentucky State University, Michael Bomford's program, has shown that with the double layer of plastic, you're gonna get a 5 to 10 degree increase in temperature with that double layer. With ours, we would retain a couple degrees, maybe 2 to 3 degrees at night, we wouldn't retain as much. So for the crops we were growing, the cool season stuff, you can get away with not having that double layer, but you do get a little, retain more heat if you have that double layer on there. So getting your money back out of these tunnels, Lynn Bozinski and Dan Nagengas from Wild Onion Farm, they grow vegetables and flowers in Kansas. Lynn's also the one that's the editor for Growing for Market, which probably a lot of you are subscribed to. If you're not, it's an excellent publication and you should sign up for it. But they built 5 hoop houses that are 20 by 96 each, and they purchased their cold frames from Polar Cub, from Stuppy Greenhouse, and the cost for 2 houses was $32.50. That's the metal frame, the poly covering, the wiggle wire to attach it to the frame, plus their shipping. Shipping's important, very important when you're shipping steel around, so make sure you factor that in when you're thinking about purchasing one of these. And then they have their lumber for roll-up sides and end walls was $1,600, and their bulldozing and laser leveling of the site that they wanted to put the tunnels on was $300. So for 2 houses, it cost them a little over $5,000, which is very reasonable. In the first year, their hoop houses produced twice what they cost. So that's pretty good return on them. And this is what they were producing in there. They did a lot of cut flowers, and as the vegetable specialist, it pains me to see these flowers getting more money per square foot than the vegetables, but that's the reality. So in the fall, their highest grossing crops were dianthus and larkspur. So from dianthus, they were getting over $5 per square foot. So you can see if you have a 20 by 96 foot tunnel, that's just slightly under 2,000 square feet. You're getting $5 per square foot. There's your tunnel back and then some in 1 year. You can see there for the vegetables, the cool season crops, we're getting about $1 a square foot, if we're lucky. I think lettuce, this was from 2000, so I think you could get a lot more from lettuce now, and it's also depending on how you plant it. We don't know what their planting system was like, but the Weidigers get $4.50 for 6 ounces of lettuce during the winter. So they're getting a good return on their lettuce.
Are these folks organic growers?
They are. Mm-hmm. In the spring, I'm happy to report that their tomatoes were getting $3.50 per square foot. So we did get up there with the vegetables in the springs planted things. But you're still getting good return on your cut flowers. And that's really something to think about, even if you are mainly vegetables. Putting those flowers in there, you can put a row of flowers in and you can increase your revenue. And also, if you're a farmer's market grower, it makes your booth look real pretty at the market. So it draws people in because they see the flowers and then you have the vegetables and they go hand in hand. And we've always intended to plant some cut flowers between our tunnels. partially for beneficial habitat, and so we have flowers around, and we haven't done it yet, but one of these years we'll get to it. Wave.
How are hoop houses for herbs? I've had requests for more herbs with our CSA boxes.
There, with the herbs, they do very well. Lots of herbs will grow in these, but especially during the winter time, you want to make sure that you're growing herbs that can handle the cool weather. You don't want to grow something like basil, which will get chilling injury very, very quickly. But cilantro does well in these. It's on their list for the fall planted crop up there. It does very well in the tunnels.
I guess I was thinking more of Mediterranean style, things like thyme, let's say basil, thyme.
Rosemary?
Yeah, I don't know. Of course, rosemary.
Yeah, rosemary will grow anywhere. I wouldn't waste your tunnel space on it, but basil, don't put in there for the fall. For the spring, it would go crazy and do well. Elizabeth, do you have something to add?
I know Allison Winkler says that she has a huge pot of rosemary that she keeps. It's in a pot, a physical pot, but she actually has had this rosemary tree, I guess, for like 7 or 8 years, and she keeps it in the corner of the hoop house in the winter and cuts it for all of her starts in the spring, but pulls it somehow or another, pulls this monstrous pot outside or through the roll-up side or something for the summer. So yeah, it's a good idea.
That is a good idea. All right, now I'm going to talk a little bit about what we grew in our smaller tunnels in 2008 and 2009. And we definitely made a lot of mistakes, and we're still learning on our tunnels. So this project, we looked at three varieties of each of 11 different crops in our high tunnels and low tunnels, and we replicated it. And we took measurements, of course, on the growth and harvest data. And there's more detailed information up on our website on this project, and I'm not going to go painstakingly through all that now, but I will tell you a little bit about it. And we started this experiment at the end of October, and we ended it in mid-March of 2009. So these are the varieties that we used for the various crops. We had DiCicco broccoli and Waltham and Bellstar. We've never done very well with broccoli on this farm yet. We're still waiting to do well with broccoli. It seems like we always have some issue with our broccoli, and that didn't do very well for us in the tunnels either. We did very well with the spinach, and the butterfly was the best variety of our spinach that we grew that year. The kale does very well inside the tunnels, and all of those varieties did well. The Lacinato is the dinosaur kale, and folks really like that because it has the nice crinkled leaves to it. And the Red Russian, of course, is red, so it gives you some variety. And then the True Siberian is another Russian-type kale. The lettuce, we also had a variety of lettuces in there, and they all did fairly well. The Swiss chard, we had Chadwick's Choice and Gladder Silber. And I think Gladder Silber was the preferred one just because the students like to say Gladder Silber instead of Chadwick's Choice.
I prefer the drunken, grizzly headed
person. We also did leeks. The Swiss chard did fairly well, yeah.
Now, were most of these seeded on that day to not late October?
A lot of these things were direct seeded in there.
And it was that late.
Yep. And that was later than we wanted to. That was the first year we had the tunnels up, so we didn't get them up and prepared in time. That's another good point to mention. If you're planning a lot of these things, we would have had a much better success if we would have started in September on those. So out of getting them ready and getting things in them, we were later that year of putting them in.
What kind of problems did you have with the broccoli?
Oh, we never get our broccoli to actually form heads.
Only inside the tunnels?
No, outside. Outside the tunnels, I think it's a fertility issue more than anything else. We're not getting enough nitrogen to them. But that was kind of part of our study that we were looking at cover crops, seeing if we could get enough nitrogen out of the cover crops and living mulches. Another last fall, we planted broccoli, and it was our best broccoli, actually. But we were looking at rolling down the cover crop with the roller crimper that we have, and also comparing that to the rolling it with the flail mower, just disengaging the mower and rolling it. Well, in 2008, we had some cowpeas that we rolled down in this field right here. Easy to roll, they looked great. Rolled them in one pass, they were dead. 2009, those cowpeas were very, very healthy. It was a wetter year. They wouldn't die for anything. So we rolled them multiple times, they'd pop back up. So then we decided to look at organic burn down herbicides to try to kill the cowpeas. And so we looked at clove oil and we looked at vinegar. And something about that clove oil attracted something to the broccoli, and all the broccoli that we planted in the clove oil was mowed to the ground, eaten. The good news is they didn't like the vinegar, and we still had broccoli in the vinegar plots, but that was kind of the end of our study when we didn't have any treatments. We only had vinegar plots. So, as I've said, we've had a little issue with broccoli on the farm, but one of these years we'll work out broccoli production here. I think Lee jinxed us this year because he was making comments before our broccoli was ever even near getting ready and saying, "Are you sure we're going to have broccoli?" I said, "Yeah, Lee, we'll have broccoli this year. Of course we will." We didn't have broccoli. All right. So leeks. Leeks did very well inside of our tunnels, and all those varieties did well for us. Radishes, we tried some regular round types, and we put in the round black Spanish to have a little variety, and then the cherry bell, which is a good standard variety, and then we put in a daikon to have the longer French types. Cauliflower, broccoli relative. We can't grow it. Other folks do well, we don't.
Because they're non-mycorrhizal. That's the problem.
That's what it is. It's their non-mycorrhizal. We need to stick to the mycorrhizal crops. That might be true. Kohlrabi, we did good with kohlrabi outside the tunnels this spring. The beets didn't do very well for us in the tunnels when we grew them, and the sweet peas didn't do very well either, but again, I think that's late planting and we didn't get them in early enough.
The beets,
we didn't get good beets out of there. And we didn't get good peas.
Did you grow beets that were not in the tunnel?
We grew them in a low tunnel, and we didn't get any crops out of our low tunnels because it was too cold, and we didn't get enough heat in the low tunnels. That was what we were looking at, comparing the high and the low, and the low didn't give us the heat that we needed. We didn't get carrots. Carrots are tricky in our clay soil, and our onions, we got some onions out of there. But this is what our tunnels look like during that winter time, and these photos are actually out of an article they did in the Knox News Sentinel. So we did get some radishes. So we found that our soil temperatures in our tunnels were 5 to 10 degrees warmer than in our low tunnels, and our high tunnels were 5 to 10 degrees warmer. The high tunnel crops outperformed those in the low tunnels, which you might expect, as no plants in the low tunnels were harvested. The crops that performed well for us were the kale, leeks, spinach, radish, and lettuces. And we've talked about those crops that didn't perform so well. We did get a few onions though, but they weren't large onions, they were small onions. And this is just another photo inside the tunnel. So some of the lessons we learned were that harvest times are lengthened in the high tunnels over the winter, which is pretty standard. A lettuce that you think you're going to harvest in 50 days is going to take you a lot longer in the tunnel in the winter, so keep that in mind. You're not going to get as many cuttings off the lettuce when you're harvesting it in the winter as you would in the spring or the summer outside. Timing is key. You want to plant your late maturing crops and transplants earlier, or we wanted to plant them earlier, which John already brought up for us that we were late getting those in there. Keeping the tunnels airtight is important, and that was a big issue in 2008. We had a lot of air moving through our tunnels, and we made adjustments to our tunnel to seal those ends better last year. Also, covering the inside with a row cover on below freezing days is important. So even though you have a tunnel, another layer of warmth is good in those tunnels. John?
Keeping the high tunnels airtight is important. But didn't we just talk about orienting the tunnels so that you get maximum ventilation?
Yes, that's a good point. And in the winter, you don't want maximum ventilation. Generally, you want to keep them closed to retain your heat. But on a, if you're using them for warm season crops and getting that advantage in the spring, when it's going to be warm in there, you want to be able to open them. So that's why I mentioned with the weedigers that theirs are tight and they don't have roll-up sides, and that's because they're mainly using those for winter production or fall production of cool season crops, the lettuce and things. So they want to retain that heat. If you want to use them to get the advantage on warm season crops in the spring, then you do want to have the ability to raise and lower the sides. Wave and then John.
So do you not have to worry about too much heat if you, like when we get that 70 degree week in January sometimes, will that cook your stuff in there?
It can cook your stuff, but generally you can open your doors, and on their tunnels, on that picture I showed of their tunnels, it was a ways back I guess, they also have windows on the ends of their tunnels, so they can open all that up and they're going to get more airflow. In our tunnels, we have large doors and we can open the ends up, and we do that sometimes during the winter. Generally in the winter we don't mess with the sides as much as we mess with the doors. So if we want some airflow in there, we can still open the doors. So that's important when you're thinking about doors too, that you're going to get enough airflow if you do have that 70 degree day in January where they're going to heat up. Thanks for bringing that up. Some of these things, you know, you think you set them in your head and you haven't. So it's good that you're keeping me in check, John. And you had a question or comment?
I just covered it.
Okay.
Thanks.
All right. So though we had some issues growing in our tunnels, this is what the weedigers' tunnels look like on a day in January. And this is a real neat slide set that they have to just show you what these tunnels can do, and it's pretty amazing. So we'll go through this, and you can see here, you can see their windows at the end of the tunnel here. So they have a door on one end only, but then they have windows going across the end of the tunnel. And those windows are pretty easy to put in. They're just 2x4s, and they have the plastic over them. Their sides are just more of that 6 mil plastic. They don't have the polycarbonate like we have on our ends. And that does just fine and saves you a lot of money. So this was January 27th. The temperature outside was 14 degrees. And this is the frost on the front of the cold frame. So you can see it's gold. And at 8 a.m., the temperature inside the tunnel was about 22 degrees. And as you can see, the lettuce transplants and the kale look terrible. And when Paul and Allison are talking about this at SOG, Paul's getting all worked up all over again, telling you how terrible they looked. And Allison works outside the home. And so Paul calls her up and says, "Allison, everything's gone. The tunnel is dead. We lost everything." And here's the red oak leaf lettuce, frozen, frost all over it. And then that same kale, an hour later, the temperature's already 32 degrees in the tunnel. And the oak leaf lettuce, you can see it's perked up quite a bit. And then at 10 a.m., it's 50 degrees inside that tunnel, and everything's mostly recovered. And Paul keeps going in and giving Allison the update, keeps calling her. And here's that oak leaf lettuce the same time, so it's looking way better. The ice crystals are gone. At 2 p.m., it's 80 degrees inside that tunnel, and everything's recovered. So Paul calls Allison, and Allison says, "Paul, don't call me before noon anymore." Outside, it's still 19 degrees. So that shows you what a sunny day can do in the tunnel and what kind of temperatures you can get in there. And so that's a pretty amazing little slide sequence that they have, and I like to show that.
That's with the sunny day.
That's with the sunny day, yep.
But that's not on a sunny day, you've got that temperature.
On a sunny day, if you don't have a sunny day, you're gonna be in trouble if you have that low of a temperature and it remains that low throughout the whole day. But we're also generally warmer than they are because we're south of them some. But that's when you want to make sure that you do have an airtight tunnel and that you do have that double layer of plastic to get extra insulation. But a little sun goes a long way in these tunnels. They warm up pretty quick if the sun's out at all, even for an hour. So there are other types of tunnels, and Haygrove tunnels are ones that are fairly popular, and then the movable tunnels, and we'll talk about these a little bit. The Haygroves are generally a multi-bay tunnel system, and the idea behind these is more of rain protection. They're not going to have end walls on them. The ends are going to be open. And many growers plant erect these over acres of crops. Instead of 20 by 96 area, you would cover a much larger area with these. And they're going to protect high-value crops from early and late frost and rain and wind and hail and disease. And they can also be used for shading and bird netting over fruit crops like blueberries or things like that. So the Haygrove Company was founded in England in 1988, and they did this over 2 acres of strawberries. By 2002, they had expanded to 250 acres of soft fruits, and those included blackberries, red currants, and cherries, as well as the strawberries. And generally, the Haygroves are going to be 18 to 28 feet wide per bay, and there's a 3-bay minimum on constructing these. So their upfront costs are going to cost you more. They're less per square foot, but you have to have a greater square footage that you're covering, so they end up costing you more to start with. There's no walls in between these bays, so they're just open, and there's no limit for the length. So you can cover these from 65 feet to over 1,000 feet long. And now you might be saying, you said don't do them over 100 feet. But because these are different, they're not closed on the ends, and they can be open on the sides as well. You're going to get airflow through these, and it's not going to be an issue like it is in a tunnel that has end walls on it. So these have been used in California to cover anywhere from a third of an acre to 100 acres of blueberries. And they can be built on slopes too, so the slope isn't an issue with the Haygrove system either. And they're generally going to cost you about 55 cents per square foot, but if you're putting that over an acre, it's going to cost you $24,000. So a little more upfront cost than that $2,500 tunnel we talked about earlier. But Alex and Betsy Hitt, who are growers in North Carolina, they covered 2 quarter-acre blocks with Haygrove tunnels, and they planted one block of their heirloom tomatoes, and traditionally in their field crop of heirlooms, they get a five-week harvest season out of it, and then they're dead from foliar disease. In the Haygroves, they picked that same number of plants for 10 weeks, and they increased their profit by 35%. So keeping the rain off your plants goes a long way, and if you have that covering over them, it'll really help with disease. Going back to the berries, this is data from the Haygrove Company themselves, so you can take it with a grain of salt since, of course, they want to sell their product. But for strawberry yields, for outdoor production, they were getting 8.1 tons per acre, and inside the tunnel, they were getting 9.5 tons. But beyond that, the class number one fruit, they were getting 87% in that category versus 73% outside. And the raspberries are the same way. They were getting 4 tons outside the tunnels and 5 tons inside the tunnels. And 97% of the fruit were class one, and they were harvesting them 2 weeks earlier. And this is data from Haygrove, but Kathy Demchek from Penn State has done a lot of work with berries in tunnels, and they consistently find much greater yields for raspberries inside the tunnels versus outside the tunnels. And the Dysingers also have raspberries in their tunnels, the folks I mentioned in Williamsport. And originally they thought, ooh, we can plant these closer together than they're recommending for raspberry plants. And so they underestimated the growth of the raspberries and ended up taking out a row of raspberries the next year because they couldn't get in there to pick them because they had so much lush growth inside the tunnels. So other things that you might not have thought about growing under a tunnel and that grow under the Haygroves are cherry trees and plum trees and sugar snap peas on a trellis system. And they've done a lot of work with the tree fruit in Michigan State. And it looked like for a while that the hay grubs were preventing cracking on the cherries because they weren't getting the overhead rain over them, and so they weren't cracking. But then they had a year with just huge amounts of rain, and it looked like the cracking, they were still getting the water coming up through the roots, and so they were still getting the cracking. But it looked encouraging in a semi-dry year to prevent cracking of the cherries, but in a very wet year, you still got cracking because they were up taking so much water through the roots. So hay grove tunnels are not designed to carry a snow load, which isn't too big of an issue here. They're designed as temporary low-cost structure, and they can be moved with the crop, which is an advantage. And that's another thing, the movable tunnels. So if you're just thinking of putting up a tunnel, I would seriously encourage you to look into movable tunnels because I think they have a lot of advantages. And if I were going to do our tunnels over, I would try some movable tunnels because they can really help you maximize your space and the time of your plantings. They can reduce buildup of pests, diseases, and excess soil nutrients, which is a problem of many people who have grown in tunnels over a number of years. They get salt buildup on the surface of the soil. And it all also allows for additional rotation options. And how many of you are familiar with Elliot Coleman's Winter Harvest Handbook? A couple of you. If you're thinking about a movable tunnel, I would highly encourage you to read his book because he is really looked into the movable tunnels and has various movable tunnels on his farm. And the Dysingers are actually a good resource for that here in Tennessee. They have several different versions of the movable tunnels on their farm, and they'll be happy to tell you the pros and cons of all the movable tunnels that they have. But there are many different designs out there, and you can read more in the Winter Harvest Handbook or contact the Dysingers at Bountiful Blessings Farm. And with the movable tunnels, which Elliot Coleman lays out the designs of several different schemes that you could do, but it's really going to double the space you have, because if you can move the tunnel, you can start your warm season, your cool season crops, and then when it gets warm enough that they'll survive, you can move it off the cool season crops, start your warm season crops in the spring. So it's doubling what you can get out of the tunnel. And also, then you're not getting the area that doesn't get any natural rain, and you're not getting disease buildup because you don't have one area where you're planting the same crops over and over. You're rotating your space. And he goes through two crops and three crops and five crops in the book. So if you're just starting out, I would look into a movable design because I think there's a lot of advantages, and a lot of folks are seeing these problems with their tunnels with buildup of soil-borne pathogens and buildup of salts and things in the soil after 5 and 10 years of growing in a stationary tunnel. John?
You said you had some drainage problems here. What was going on there?
We have drainage problem because we have our tunnels are on a slope. The end, it slopes down into the tunnel, so we would get rain in there. We just need to dig it out at the end.
Is there a reference to this author's name of the Winter Harvest Handbook?
It's Elliot Coleman. And I actually have a copy of it over in my bag, but I didn't put it out because I thought someone would steal it. But you can look at it. You can look at my copy if you promise not to steal it over there. He also has the Four Season Harvest, which is another good book, and he's the one that wrote The New Organic Grower, where he talks about movable tunnels there too. So those are all good reference books. All right, so a lot of this was adapted from the ATRA publication on season extension for market gardeners, and also a Haygrove presentation. And there's lots more resources here at the end. So you have these and the resource list that we gave you. And then there's manufacturers and suppliers. And there's lots of those. John, where did you just order your frame from?
Well, this is a guy connected with the Noble Foundation and the Kerr Institute in Oklahoma.
Mm-hmm.
And he has built very cheap greenhouses with square steel.
Mm-hmm.
And so I ordered the steel out of Atlanta, but he just puts together a description of something that's extremely cheap, and I thought I'd try it for the first time. If anyone's interested, you know, I can give an email address. It's, I can't remember his name right now, but he'll come to me.
Okay. That's the other thing that I didn't put in here, but it's worth mentioning. There's a lot of low-cost options now using PVC pipe for your frame instead of steel. And while they're very low cost, a couple hundred dollars instead of a couple thousand dollars, I would discourage you, because one good wind after you've have your crop, you're invested in your crop under there, you get a good wind that takes down your tunnel and takes out your crop, you're not saving anything. So I would recommend the steel frame. The PVC pipe, there's lots of information on PVC pipe tunnels out there, but again, you know, you're investing your time and getting that crop going, and you don't want...
What about for low tunnels?
For our low tunnels, we do use PVC, and we can look at them when we go up there.
Actually, we use the electrical conduit because it's UV resistant.
Thank you, Jeff. And we put it over rebar, right?
I think the UV also, no? I mean, the UV, PVC degrade the plastic even faster than just UV, so another reason not to use it.
I got my high tunnel from a place in Cookeville, and they shipped it free.
Oh, you bought it right in Cookeville.
Uh-huh. This growersolution.com.
Growersolution. So what do we put our electrical conduit over, Jeff?
I think we adapted that like Coleman's method, where we use soil probe to go about 6 to 10 inches down, and then actually just stick the conduit in the soil, and the tension that it exerts and the pressure keeps it up in the ground.
All right. That's why Jeff's here. All right. So we'll take a little break now, and then we'll go out to the tunnels. But I wanted to thank you all for attending our workshops this year. If you disperse later and I don't get a chance to thank you, this is our last workshop of the year, and we'll be sending you all emails about what you want to hear for next year. And I think next year we're going to adopt more on-farm workshops. So if you have a farm and you want to volunteer to be a host for one of our workshops, we'd love to have that as well. So you can either email me or Heather, and we will be sending you a survey for topics for next year and ways we can improve for next year. So please fill it out so we have feedback and we can go from there. All right, well, we'll take a little break unless someone has some questions, and then we'll walk out to the tunnels.
I thought we'd just do a demonstration real quick before we started talking about the high tunnels. And PVC works fine for this method. The electrical conduit just lasts longer. It is more expensive. But basically, this is just to take soil cores. We go down a little bit and actually just stick this straight in the ground. And this is what we were doing all last week also. And it's really simple. It helps for the soil to be moist. So that's why it's going to be a little more difficult in the high tunnels. And you just kind of bend this to go straight down. And the pressure keeps it in. And that's it. So it's really, really simple to do.
And you only had them that deep, or did you go
deeper? A little bit deeper, but we go anywhere from around 8 inches is our general rule. The deeper you go, the harder they are to pull out at the end of the season. So,
now, do you ever use just hammer a rebar in the ground and then slip that over it?
Yes. That proves to be very difficult at the end of the winter.
Yeah.
It kind of acts like concrete.
Yeah.
So you can really hurt yourself trying to get that out. But it does work well.
To get the rebar out?
To get the rebar out of the soil.
Why would you?
Well, instead of you put the rebar in and then you just slide the PVC over it.
But why would you take the rebar out if you wouldn't do it again?
It depends on what you're using your field for. The longer you keep metal objects like that in clay soils, it tends to attract to that metal and acts like concrete.
See, we have really dirty soil, and getting a soil tube into it is impossible.
Oh, yeah.
We can't even put up signs for our workshops.
Right.
Pound holes. Yeah.
So
I missed what the kind of material that was. Is that PVC?
That's electrical conduit.
Okay.
But PVC works well, too. It may not last quite as long, but...
What is your comparison of how long PVC lasts?
Oh, I'm not really sure how long. I've used PVC for at least 3 seasons before. Huh. But then you risk it might crack. It depends.
Brittle.
Mm-hmm.
But this didn't.
Is it medium or is it heavy?
That's heavy.
This is heavy.
Yes.
Now, do you connect those in any way? Is there any support between your...
No.
I've seen some applications where they make a string purlin and then stretch it tight and then stake it at each end.
Mm-hmm.
And I was just wondering if that is what we're trying to get away from is a sag that you see between there. But
right.
I was just curious whether or not that works. I've seen pictures of it, but I...
Yeah, I have no experience with that. These are spaced a little bit further. These are 10-foot spacing. Typically, you go around 6 feet. It depends, too, on the weight of the material you're going to be using and how long throughout the season you plan to use it. This is temporary for the lettuce, but...
And that's what you have under here, lettuce?
We have lettuce and strawberries underneath.
Lettuce on black plastic. Are you setting out plants?
Mm-hmm. Transplants.
You're doing transplants.
Right.
You can't seed onto black plastic, right?
It's more difficult. You could.
I mean, what we've always had to break open the plastic. I just wondered if there was some magic thing that you could, that would drill through the plastic and make it.
I don't think so, no. No, it's...
You develop one.
Yeah. Well, if you guys want, we can walk over to the hot tunnels and take a look inside. Very often.
Yeah.
That's maybe once a week.
Yeah.
I mean, a few weeks ago we were going maybe twice a week. But I believe we watered once last week and it's still pretty moist. Yeah. So these are the new hot tunnels, and these are, I guess you would call these the roll down sides, or I don't know, I get confused because to have them open you roll them down, but they're shut right now so we actually have to roll them up. And if you notice there are a lot of parts to this system, so the more parts you have, the more possibilities of those parts to break. And we've found that out after this first season. But this is part of a SCRI project funded by the USDA. And right now we're doing the variety trial, which you see. There's 6 varieties of lettuce. You only see 5 because our seed supplier ran out of the other seeds, so we were forced to come down to 5. And then these are 6 varieties of strawberries. So these are all planted in black plastic. During the summer, we also do tomato production, and that's where these 2 middle rows had tomatoes in them. And this row on the right is similar to the lettuce and strawberry research, where it's in black plastic, 6 varieties of the tomato crop. This row with all the flags is part of our biodegradable mulch study, and I actually have some samples of the mulches we're using. So we're using one variety of tomato, and we're looking at the effects that these mulches have on the soil and disease and water moisture and weed pressure. So if you guys want to pass those around. They're all labeled. One is a spun bond, which is a polylactic acid. It's actually similar to the low tunnel, where it's a cotton film. And we found that after this first season that weeds tend to grow underneath from the light penetration. So that's kind of one, I guess one objective we're hoping to overcome. And then we also have two starch-based, the BioBag and BioTello. And those are supposed to break down by the end of the season and be incorporated into the soil. But for the research that we're doing, we didn't actually incorporate them. We cut samples from what we laid out during the season, and they're actually buried. That's what this disorganization of all the flags, there is organized chaos. We have samples of these buried in mesh bags to study the soil ecology, what's happening with the microbes and the breakdown process, and they will be taken out over the next 3 years, next spring, next fall, and then the subsequent years following. And we will actually send those to our soil specialists, who will look at all the effects and the differences occurring with those. So the spring and, or the lettuces, spring and fall crop that we've planted, and the strawberries we planted this past, started in October, and we will cover these for our winter protection and start harvesting in early spring. And that's what we were referring to with the pollination of the bumblebees, is we'll need some pollinators right there at the end of February, beginning of March, and not much will be out. So we're going to try to use the bumblebees to see if we can provide adequate pollination. And this biodegradable mulch study, it's a continuing process. We have two more years of research left after this season, and we hope to better, explain the degradability of these products and see their true effects on the soil and their lifespan. Right now, it's understood that they do break down, but we're trying to actually look at how well they break down. So back to the high tunnels, as you can see, these vents up top, inside it's got a little hydraulic black plastic, and basically there's wax inside of that, and as it heats, it opens and expands. So this vent opens up, and as it cools, it closes back, so at night these will be shut. And this is the polycarbonate walls that we're referring to. It's a little more expensive than just the regular 6 mil plastic, but it lasts a lot longer.
When you said you were going to cover the strawberries and the lettuce, aren't they already covered because they're in here, or are you doing more coverage?
Well, we'll cover the strawberries just to give them right in here for extra protection. Because, in January, February, it gets pretty chilly. And even though, these structures do retain heat at night, they lose a lot of heat too. So that's just to make sure that we can provide enough.
What do you cover them with?
The low tunnels.
Okay.
Yeah, we'll just have to build some more out inside of here. But the lettuce will be done by then. We won't cover those, hopefully. But we'll see. So we also have some other types of high tunnel structures next door, if you want to walk over to those.
I had a question about this.
Yes.
Do you do any regular soil amendments here, or is it you just started with the initial condition and you're just using it for experiments like you're showing us? Are you adding any organic soil conditioners, or manure, or anything like that?
Okay, so the question is, what are we adding, or are we adding anything to
right.
the soil? Initially, we took soil tests at the beginning of each season, and we used soybean meal and whatever other amendments are needed. We had to apply some bone meal this fall to balance everything out. Other than that, we're treating this organically, so we aren't actually adding composts.
Now, are you also monitoring the soil tests to see if you can maintain those levels with that kind of regimen?
Yes, this is the first season that we're using this, so this following spring. We did add more in the fall for the lettuce and strawberries. Mm-hmm. So after this round, we'll do another round of tests late winter and to decide what we need to supply.
I've heard that in some conditions you have a hard time maintaining your phosphorus level under organic situations, that you may not be able to build up your soil phosphorus levels adequately for intensive cropping. I was just wondering if that's an issue.
Specifically for high tunnels or organics?
Well, or for organics. But I would assume that in a high tunnel, you're going to have higher temperatures, so you're going to be oxidizing your soil material a lot faster. And I was just curious about whether or not you could maintain that.
I believe with organics, it's like any system. As long as you have the right approach where you're providing amendments, whether it's cover crops or manures, I don't believe that would be as big of an issue. From the growers that I've spoke with, that doesn't come up very much. With high tunnels, it can become more difficult since you're not receiving the rainfall. You're not getting the washout of the nutrients, so you can get a lot of salt build up like Annette was referring to. But hopefully that sort of answers your question. But anything else?
They're flying.
Okay, thanks.
You said we're managing it organically, so we're not using compost. What do you think about that?
Well, for this size, we don't use compost because we don't. A lot of companies that make their own compost don't follow the standards required for organics. I believe specifically urea is added to a lot of composts which don't qualify for organic standards for compost. But that's just because of the local suppliers we have aren't providing organic compost. So it's possible.
I just wanted to clarify that.
Okay. Sure. Yeah, no, there's nothing wrong with compost. And you can cover crop high tunnels too, but you need, a good chunk of the growing season, and usually you have your high value, your cash crops in the ground, so that can be more difficult. We'll walk down to the other high tunnels.
Do you want to talk about the advantage of the roll down versus roll up?
This kind, whether you call it roll down or roll up, since it rolls to the ground, there's more space, more air movement. We have a larger gap to provide that movement of air, basically. I like these better, the space it provides. It's just this system with the cranks on the ends right here can be difficult. And you actually can hook it up to a drill. They do have adapters for that. But we are manual right now. So if it's just a one-person operation, that kind of gets tiresome. Now with the other, I guess, roll up. What would you say the advantages are? I'm not really...
Well, for this one, when you plant young transplants in here in the spring, and it is a little cooler, and it is a little cooler, if you have the sides that roll down from the top, you can keep it higher up, so it's not going to get that coldest air right at the level of those tender transplants. So it's going to protect them a little better. And also, if you have critters, this can keep the critters out because they're not going to get in right at the ground level. So if you have rabbits or something, they're not going to jump over half the curtain if it's rolled down instead of rolled up.
But it's not touching the ground.
Yeah. What's not touching the ground?
The base looks like it doesn't touch the ground. Am I missing something?
This is not rabbit proof.
Well, it has the plastic over it, and then we have soil over it on the edge. Yeah, so it's okay. They can't get in that from there.
Now what, is there an issue with having the... looks like these are very close together in terms of not maximizing your flow when you want airflow. Is there an optimum space between tunnels that improves the circulation, or is that an issue at all? That's, you see what I'm saying?
Yeah, that's really nice.
These are a little close, but this is kind of what we had to work with for space.
Yeah, we had to fit it all in one field. That was part of the...
Typically, they are spaced out a little bit more.
Is there a...
I'm not sure if there's a minimum, probably 20, 30 feet.
Half the height.
Is it half the height?
Yeah.
Okay.
How do you
so it's almost.
It's then if it were half the height, it'd be pretty close. Did you have a question, John?
Yeah, I'm not leaving understanding why there's a woven fabric inside the plastic wall, and it doesn't look like air flows through it, so I'm trying to figure out why it's there.
It's just right in the corner.
There are two layers.
Oh, that prevents gaps. You'll see in the next, there's less holes that way. Whenever we roll it down, it still allows air movement, but whenever you roll it up, if you didn't have that plastic that goes around the corner, you have a lot more holes in the system to allow the warm air to escape. Is that what you're referring to? Or?
You mean
no,
the,
it
the run, cloth
runs
or?
All along the wall yeah. here. There's plastic, and then there's also this woven.
Are you just talking about the strings? What do you mean the woven? I'm not following you.
Yeah, okay.
This is the one that...
This rolls down.
Rolled down, and the plastic's only going to right here.
Okay, so this is the wall out. Okay.
Yeah. Yeah.
Okay, I didn't understand that.
The other thing about this tunnel is it has the steel baseboard, which if you're certified organic, you can't use treated wood as your baseboard. And so in our other tunnels, we have untreated wood, but if you're using untreated wood in your tunnel, it's going to degrade faster and you're gonna have to replace that. So we put the metal in here to see how it worked for us. And there is the gap there. It doesn't go all the way down to the ground, and we've had some weed issues around the edge, and
yeah, a lot of water comes in.
Keeping the plastic buried on the other edge to prevent gaps. So there's been some issues with it, but that's what we wanted to see, differences between this system and that system. And we're trying to spend the money so you don't have to spend it on unnecessary things.
Do you know if that plastic recycled lumber, I don't know what it's called, is
a composite?
It's not. Mm-mm. Other components in there that make it not acceptable. And there's a bunch of variations of those plastics now. And so the best thing to do would be to check with your certifier.
If you use untreated wood, do you have any termite problems here?
We don't.
Because on my place, you lay a piece of wood down, you're going to have a termite building an entire colony in it. In about 10 minutes, yeah. In a week, you know, you pick up a board, anything, pick it up, and it's filled with termites.
Yeah, that would be another issue.
And ideally, this base, the steel base, would be flush with the soil on.
Yeah.
Do you get that from grading it before you put this thing up?
Actually, when you're installing it. But
around the ground.
Yeah. That was missed for the construction process.
Mm-hmm. What's the white powder on the strawberries?
Oh, that's diatomaceous earth, the powder on the strawberries. We're having a small slug problem. They like to stay under the black plastic since it's moist and warm, mm-hmm. and come out at night and feed on some of the leaves. So we're just kind of trying to halt that for the time being before it gets cool enough.
So how do you work this? How do you work up the soil?
How do we work up the soil? We have a little Kubota.
Uh-huh.
And this, it fits through the door. Mm-hmm. And that's what we use to till the soil.
Okay.
It works for us.
That's another consideration when you're thinking about what kind of doors to put on your tunnel. Some people just have like a door that you have on your house, and it all depends on how you're planning on working up your soil. If you do want to get a piece of equipment in there, or if you're doing it mostly, you know, by hand. Or
the Weedigers use a tiller.
They have
like 5 or 7, and they just go in with the tiller, and that's why they have those leftover aluminum frame doors. Because he just muscles it through the door.
Because, I mean, a Ford 5000 is the smallest thing we've got.
And that's what helps with the removable in walls, too. If you can take them apart relatively easily,
Then
you can just make a big enough spot for you to come through.
I didn't show you other end walls, but some of them are like a garage door at the end that you just lift up so you can really get a larger tractor through it. The edges, we still have issues with getting right to the edges with our tractor, but, you know. And yeah, there's lots to think about.
If you want to show them, you can, no, I meant you can roll the sod down. I don't need that workout today. But did you see these transplants that are in the soil? We just put those in last week. They were already the size of the ones we had outside.
And the other one. But we brought you down to this one to show you our fire ants in the end. And the designs they make.
Right up the column.
On the wall?
That's really weird.
Oh, where? That's fine.
Mm-hmm.
Yep. My goodness.
Wow, they look happy too.
Yeah, I kind of ticked them off. Trying to get the door open. Well, this is the other type of system where it has the roll-up sides, and these are much easier to operate, but as you see, there are more gaps to let the heat out. On the previous one, we had the plastic that wrapped around, but with these, we actually screwed this shut last winter to help, but you still get gaps.
Huh. And tearing of plastic as you
right.
can see.
Then this is that double layer, but
and this is the one that you don't want to do what we did. It has a double layer of plastic that's on top of each other, so we're degrading it faster.
Yeah, and you can see it kind of sweating.
Yeah, you can see it sweating if you look in here. And you'll notice in this one it has the wood for the sideboards at the bottom.
A lot of weeds.
These tunnels were put up in the fall of 2008. And those tunnels were put up last year. So these tunnels are a year older, but they also have the round seal instead of the square seal for the frame. No vents on the side, on the ends, except for the doors.
Did you make a statement about which is preferred, the round or the square? I can't remember.
I don't think so.
We don't really have a preference for one or the other.
The square is easier to construct than the round. Better because it is round, and so there's rounded surfaces for the plastic and all. But
that's
it's more difficult to work with putting screws in the round because it's round. It slips. It does this to you.
Yeah.
But the square is easier.
Once you get it there, it's better, but it's harder on the front end.
Yes.
Get
a lot of busted knuckles. Yes.
So really, it's according on how much money you want to invest in these types of systems and what would work best for the crops you want to grow. there's a lot to choose from, so.
Absolutely.
And how high do these sides roll up? Do they roll all
just
the
below
way
the wood?
The wood?
Yeah.
All the way to the wood at the top.
Yeah. Okay.
This tells you I roll up this thing like better.
Yeah.
Roll the other
one. No, I don't want to roll the other one.
Wouldn't those objects crank if you had longer handles? Wouldn't they be a lot easier?
Not necessarily. It's, you're talking about, you're pulling the entire weight, so you have that steel pole going the length and the plastic. So the longer the crank, the more room you have to move it around, and you don't want that fluctuation. You want as, the shorter one does hurt. I've busted up my knuckles a few times on those, but I don't think you would be able to roll it up as nearly as quickly with a long handle. But that's where they also have an adapter.
No effort at all in putting it up, and it seems like all the effort's in the handle because it's offset from here to here.
Right.
It's just so much more leverage than there to there.
Mm-hmm.
So just an observation. Mm.
I wish that were the case. Any more questions?
Why aren't you growing anything in here right now?
I will defer that to Annette.
Just curious.
The reason we're not growing anything in these right now is we have a new organic researcher, and these are now his tunnels, and he just started in June.
Okay.
So.
If you had electricity out here and you put a fan in here, how does that work? To get the fan to keep your...
Oh, it goes in the first layer of plastic, and then it'll blow. Between the two
how
layers.
How big of a fan are you talking about?
Tiny.
Just a little
fan.
Tiny, tiny.
Kind of like a squirrel fan.
Short,
real small.
Just put one in there?
Yep.
And it gets air all the way to the other side of this thing?
Yep.
In between the two layers. Pretty cool.
Yeah.
Okay.
Yep. So one more thing you notice, these sides aren't quite, they don't open up as tall as the others. So, once again, it's according on what you're trying to grow, how much ventilation you need.
When you get all those doors open.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah, that should be plenty of airflow.
Yeah, the issue with these, and if you come when it's colder outside, and you go in these tunnels and those tunnels, you can see the difference in heat retention.
The smaller tunnels don't retain as much heat.
They don't retain as much heat, but we also have a nice wind tunnel on the end, even though we tried to close it off. All right. Are there any other questions, comments?
Are you guys doing any kind of... fertilizer injector into your irrigation or anything like that, or just using?
We had lots of trouble with that. We were trying to put fish emulsion and it kept clogging up our dosatron.
For
I
it.
Couldn't swim in your mouth.
Yeah, so we're trying a Mazzi injector for.
Mazzi is supposed to work. I think it's a higher pressure.
Is it working better for you?
We haven't actually experimented with it yet. We just got it installed a few weeks ago, so.
But the dosatron didn't work so well?
No, it immediately clogged with the fish emulsion. There's just too much stuff in there. Too many pieces, particulates. Yeah. So we did a lot of hand fertilizing.
Yeah.
Which is not, you don't want to do that.
No.
So how much, when you look at a greenhouse like this, how much can you get out of here? I mean, it doesn't look like you have much in there. You know,
you can get a
I
lot.
I know this is just a test, but
that was the other thing with those, and that's what growers always say when we show them those tunnels. They say, well, you can tell your researchers there's nothing in these tunnels.
Yeah, exactly.
And that's true. The reason we have four rows in there is because it's an experimental tunnel, and that's what the experiment calls for. But you could get at least two more rows out of those tunnels, and we did have six rows of tomatoes in these tunnels in the
spring. So you can pack it in there pretty good.
And like you said, you can get up right to the edge. They just may not grow quite as large.
Yeah.
They look pretty full when it's full of tomatoes.
Yeah.
Yeah, particularly if you're using trellises in there, you can really chunk them.
Yeah. Mm-hmm. It does get full when the tomatoes are all grown up in there.
Annette mentioned this earlier, and it's really evident in this one. Look at all the grass along the sides of these things.
Yeah.
That grass is just a real issue in these things along the edges, because you got plastic coming down to the ground and stuff, so you keep weeding it or anything, you know, because you'll just rip that plastic all to pieces.
Could you not make the borders go into it? Would that help at all? Or
it would.
You could bury the
It would. But those edges are just a real issue. And like Jeff said, the water runs it underneath them and stuff. And we're on a bit of a slope. So on that upper slope there, it comes in from that front side on us real bad.
Mm-hmm. We get some nice puddles down that other end.
Mm-hmm. A lot of washouts.
Somebody had a big plan to ditch all that, but they never did it.
I think we got shot down.
I thought that was still in the works. Are you telling me that's over?
No, it's still in the works if I could ever get to it.
Oh, you're the somebody?
Yeah, yeah.
So your weed and your water entrance issues, is that because of the way that the type of side you have up or down, or is that just something that's endemic to the whole design of a high hoop house?
No, ours is from that end over there.
But your weed problem is...
But the weed problem...
That's just something you deal with no matter what kind you have?
Yeah, along the edge. Yeah.
Well, the more persistent you are with weeding, not allowing those weeds to go to seed.
Which we know you're all very persistent in the heart of the season when you're trying to find.
Yeah, that'll help.
Keep right on those weeds, right?
Because, I mean, you notice in the middle of the tunnels there's no weeds.
Right.
But there's no water either, so.
Yeah.
And the other thing that I've seen, and the Weedigers actually recommended if you read through Walking Through Spring, they went and got some of that really cheap, like, Master Gardener from the Big Lots ground cover stuff and rolled the sides up. And right after they built their hoop house, when they had the baseboards down but not much else, they stapled that Master ground cover over their wooden sidewalls, both sides. And then they came back and they put stuff on top of it outside. And I don't know what, I guess they kind of buried it and scooched it over on the inside. Mm. So they did that right when they had just graded that property before anything else had grown up. And I know eventually it disappears, but I guess you can go back a little bit at a time and restaple. And I've done some of that. And it does work, sort of. I mean, it's not a cure-all. Don't let me suggest that it's what you're supposed to do, but it's something you can do to lower this level of crap.
I think the real key to any sort of weed issues is limiting it, not trying to eliminate it.
Yeah.
You know, I mean, you just can't, because with these things, I mean, the sides roll up and you get weed seeds that blow in, it gets carried in by various methods. Plus, I mean, morning glory seeds, for instance, are known to survive in the soil for over 50 years, you know? So, I mean, you have lots of weed seeds in the soil, no matter where you are. So all you can do is just keep beating on it the best you can.
Yeah. Do you have any magic place for plastic disposal?
Oh, I wish I did. No, I don't have a magic place for plastic disposal. Other states like New Jersey and Pennsylvania, they have some programs where they do that. But I've tried in Tennessee and I can't find people that will take it. But if you have a contact, that would be...
I can't guarantee that we know a guy that deals in plastic recycling.
Mm.
John Witherspoon, I could give you his, and again, we'd have to find out if that specific, you know.
Yeah, and agricultural plastic, they usually don't want to deal with the dirt that gets on it, and if you have any metal staples that get in it.
We can let you know, we can ask him if that's something he would recycle and let you know.
That would be great if he did.
Yeah. then you could share that with everybody and help his business.
Sure. Where's
his?
Well, it's in East Knoxville.
We'll just contact.
South Knoxville.
Yeah, it's, I don't know exactly where, but to tell you, but we can contact you.
I had one other question that's not directly related to this, but it's in the area of soil amendments, and that is, I was wondering if there's anybody at DT or in this program that's working on a biochar as a soil amendment?
No, not directly. We were going to look at some biochar in transplant mixes, but there's a fellow at Virginia Tech that's working on biochar pretty heavily.
I mean, what's his name? We're at the University of Texas?
Virginia Tech.
Okay, Virginia Tech. Okay.
And I could get you his name. I can't think of it off the top of my head.
I don't know what that is. Is that just adding charcoal to the, like, the old-fashioned...
It is. Special charcoal.
It's
can't divide it.
It's coming from Canada, is where the most of that biochar is coming from
it's
right now.
It's already the charged where they soaked it in.
It's at high heat where they...
No oxygen.
Yeah, make it very high heat and then add it as an amendment.
Mm-hmm. We're going to try some this week to make it.
Yeah, my issue with it is importing it from Canada,
Yeah, we may
that's
do it
not
locally.
Very,
well,
so,
well, yeah, well, our idea is to, you can produce it, it's just pyrolysis at relatively low temperatures, like 600 degrees Fahrenheit, and then it's naturally alkaline, so you have to be careful with how you use it and not be sure to eat, but it has a very high cation exchange capacity, which for, on our soils, we really need.
Any other questions or comments? Well, thank you all again for coming, and we look forward to seeing you in February. You have a break from us for a few months.